Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Hadith 228. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال كنا نحضر قيام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في الظهر والعصر فحضرنا قيامه في الركعتين الأوليين من الظهر قدر ألف لام ميم تنزيل السجدة وفي الأخريين قدر النصف من ذلك وفي الأوليين من العصر على قدر الأخريين من الظهر والأخريين على النصف من ذلك. He says that we estimated the length of the standing of the Prophet in the Salat al-Dhuhr and Asr, and we estimated that in the first two rak'at of al-Dhuhr, it was the length of Alif Lam Mim al-Sajdah. So this is the length of Surat al-Sajdah, 30 ayat. And in the last two rak'at, they were half the length of the first two. So this would be about 15 ayat. And in the first two of the Asr, they were the length of the last two of the Dhuhr, and the last two of the Asr were half the length of the first two of the Asr. Muslim reported it. So what we take from this narration is that the first two rak'at of Dhuhr are of the same length. But in the previous hadith, we learned that the first rak'ah was longer than the second one. So how do we reconcile between this disparity? We could say that the previous narration includes the dua al-istiftah, which will lengthen the first rak'ah. But perhaps a better answer would be that sometimes the first two rak'at of the Dhuhr and Asr would be the same length, but most of the time the first rak'ah would be longer than the second one. So we say when you pray, then the regular practice should be that the first rak'ah is longer than the second one. But if from time to time you were to make them both the same, then there is no problem in that. Also we take from the narration that Salat al-Dhuhr is longer than Salat al-Asr. And this also makes logical sense because Salat al-Asr normally is at a time when people are working and they are busy, and they would find it hard to pray Salat al-Asr. So to make this Salah shorter would be easier for the people. As for al-Dhuhr, normally this happens when people are on their lunch break, so they can afford to lengthen it. Shaykh al-Islam says that for every Salah, the first rak'ah should be lengthened and made longer than the second rak'ah, and that this is recommended. So even though this narration talks about Dhuhr and Asr, Shaykh al-Islam says that for every Salah, the first rak'ah should be longer than the second. There is another disparity between this hadith and the previous. We find from this narration that the last two rak'ahs of al-Dhuhr are about half the length of Alif Lam Mim Tanzil al-Sajda. So this would make it about 15 ayat long. So this would then seem to suggest that in the last two of the Dhuhr, you recite more than the Fatiha, because the Fatiha is 7 ayat long. So it appears perhaps the Prophet is reciting something after Al-Fatiha in the last two rak'at of Al-Dhuhr. But we've seen from the previous narration that in the last two rak'at of the Dhuhr and Asr, he would only recite Al-Fatiha. So how do we reconcile? We say that the usual practice is that in the last two rak'at, you recite only Al-Fatiha. But sometimes, if you were to recite something other than Al-Fatiha in the last two rak'at, then this is permissible, but not the usual practice. Hadith 229, وعن سليمان ابن يسار رضي الله عنه قال كان فلان يطيل الأوليين من الظهر ويخفف العصر ويقرأ في المغرب بقصار المفصل وفي العشاء بوسطه وفي الصبح بطواله فقال أبو هريرة ما صليت وراء أحد أشبه صلاة برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من هذا أخرجه النسائي بإسناد صحيح. From Sulaiman ibn Yasar, he says that such and such a person used to pray, and he would lengthen the first two rak'at of al-Dhuhr, and he would lighten the Asr prayer, and he would recite in Salat al-Maghrib from the short surahs of the Mufassal, and in the Isha from the middle surahs of the Mufassal, and in the Subh from the long surahs of the Mufassal. And Abu Huraira said, I have not prayed behind anyone whose salah resembles that of the Prophet more than this person. The narration is sahih. So who is this person whom Sulaiman ibn Yasar is talking about? He is Umar ibn Salama, and he would lead the prayer in the Masjid al-Nabawi. And we find therefore that this is a sunnah what this person was doing, because Abu Huraira says that he is most resembling in his salah to the Prophet. So we now need to point out what do we mean by the Mufassal surahs. Mufassal means that which is divided or has intervals. And this collection of surahs is called Mufassal because they are, relatively speaking, shorter surahs in the Qur'an. And because they are shorter surahs, it means that the divisions between each surah comes rapidly. It's not like, for example, Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran and Surah Al-Nisa and Al-Ma'idah. These are long surahs, so the split between the surah comes after a long time. There is a difference of opinion as to what these surahs are. Some ulama say it starts from Surah Al-Hujurat up to and not including Surah Al-Naba. This is the longer surahs of the Mufassal. Then from Surah Al-Naba up to and not including Surah Al-Duha is the medium surahs of the Mufassal. And then from Al-Duha going to the end of the Qur'an are the shorter surahs of the Mufassal. Other ulama say that it starts from Surah Al-Qaf, going up to and not including Surah Al-Naba, then from Surah Al-Naba up to and not including Al-Duha, and then from Duha up to the end of the Qur'an. So in this way they divide the Mufassal up into three categories: the longer surahs, the medium surahs, and the shorter ones. So in Al-Maghrib he says that he would recite from the shorter ones of the Mufassal. This would be the usual practice. However, we know that it has been reported that the Prophet recited Surah Al-A'raf in Al-Maghrib. He split it between the two rak'at. He recited As-Saffat, Ad-Dukhan, Ad-Tur, Sabbih, Ad-Din, and Al-Mursalat. So the point is to recite from all over the Qur'an. And you don't always recite the short Mufassal surahs in Salat Al-Maghrib. And we find that the regular practice of Salat al-Subh is that you lengthen this Salah. And Salat al-Subh is the time when the Malaika of the night and the Malaika of the daytime are witnessing this prayer. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا. And the recitation of the Fajr, verily the recitation of the Fajr is witnessed, meaning witnessed by the Malaika. Also, many people could be sleeping at this time and they may enter the congregation late. So if you're lengthening it, it gives them a chance to catch the Salat al-Jama'ah. As for the Dhuhr and Asr, we have seen from the previous narrations how long they are meant to be. And as for Salat al-Isha, as is pointed out in this narration, he would recite from the medium length Mufassal. And so this is the case with the Imam. As for if you're praying alone, then you can lengthen it however much you want. But when you are the Imam, then you have to take into account the ability of the people behind you. So you don't shorten it too much that the others cannot pray properly, and neither do you lengthen it so much that the others will feel fatigued. Hadith 230. وعن جبير ابن مطعم رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقرأ في المغرب بالطور متفق عليه. From Jubayr ibn Mut'im he says, I heard the Prophet reciting At-Tur in the Salat al-Maghrib. So At-Tur is the name of the mountain in Sayna on which the Prophet Musa alayhi salam spoke to Allah Jalla wa Ala in a direct conversation. So here we find in this narration, Surah At-Tur is from the longer ones of the Mufassal. So it proves that the Maghrib is not always specific to the shorter surah of the Mufassal. And as we said before, it has been reported that he recited Al-A'raf, which is a very long surah. Likewise, Safat, Ad-Dukhan, Mursalat, Ad-Din. He also recited the Mu'awwidhatayn, Nas and Falaq. And all of these are authentic narrations. As for the recitation from one rak'ah to the other rak'ah, the better way and the sunnah is to recite in the order of the mushaf. So you would recite Al-Falaq in the first rak'ah and Al-Nas in the second, rather than An-Nas in the first and Al-Falaq in the second, because this is going opposite to the order of the Mus'haf. And the order of the surah is by consensus of the Sahaba. And the consensus of the Sahaba is an evidence, so it is not for us to change the order of the Mus'haf. And this is by way of recommendation, of course. Otherwise, you could recite a surah and then recite a surah which is not immediately next to it, but it comes afterwards. And there's a big gap. For example, we know that on Yawm al-Jum'ah, in the Salat al-Subh, it would be the regular practice of the Prophet to recite in the first rak'ah, Alif Lam Mim As-Sajdah, and in the second rak'ah, Hal Ata Ala al-Insan. Of course, these two surahs in the Qur'an are not next to each other, but this is what the Prophet would do. Likewise, in the two rak'ah of Fajr, in the first he would recite Al-Kafirun, and in the second, Al-Ikhlas. These are the two quick sunnah prayers. And al-gafilun and al-ikhlas are not next to each other in the mushaf. Other ulama say that even if you did rupture the order of the mushaf, it would not matter. Because the Prophet once in the nighttime prayer recited al-Baqarah, then al-Nisa, then al-Imran. So he recited surah number 2, number 4, then number 3. And this is clearly not in order. So they say this is permissible. Other ulama say that it is makrooh to do so. And the reason why the Prophet recited these three surahs in that order is because the order of the mushaf at that time was not finalized. So when now we have the finalized order of the mushaf, then it is better for us to follow this order. This narration is by Jubair ibn Mut'im. The point here is that when he heard this surah At-Tur being recited in Salat al-Maghrib, Jubair ibn Mut'im was a kafir. But when he's narrating this narration, he's a Muslim. So because of this, the ulama of hadith have said that if a kafir hears a narration from the Prophet, and then this person becomes a Muslim, and then he reports this narration which he heard during his time of kufr, then this is to be accepted. Because the consideration is to be given when he is reporting the hadith, not when he heard it. As for if a kafir was to report a narration from the Prophet, we would not accept it. Because the narration of a kafir cannot be accepted. Because the condition of al-adl is missing. As for within the surah, if you were to change the order of the ayat in the surah, then this is haram. Because the Prophet put the ayat in the surah in their proper order. And for you to change and meddle about with this order will change the meaning of the surah. As for the ordering of the surah itself in the Qur'an, then this is done by the ijtihad of the Sahaba. And it was not like the Prophet ordered them to do this, according to the majority of the ulama. But as for the ayat within the surah, this is done by the Prophet. Is it permissible to recite the same surah in the first and second rak'ah? The answer is yes. And this has been reported by the Prophet that in Salat al-Subh he recited Surat al-Zilzal in the first and second rak'ah, so he repeated it. However, this is not the normal practice. Can you recite just from the middle of a surah? The answer is yes, but again, this is not the normal practice. Hadith 231. وَعَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالْ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقْرَعُ فِي صَلَاةِ الْفَجْرِ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ ألف لام ميم تنزيل السجدة وهل أتى على الإنسان متفق عليه وللطبراني من حديث ابن مسعود يديم ذلك. From Abu Huraira, he says that on Yawm al-Jum'ah, the Prophet would recite in the Salat al-Subh, the Fard prayer, in the first rak'ah, ألف لام ميم تنزيل السجدة, and in the second rak'ah, هل أتى على الإنسان متفق عليه. And in At-Tabarani it says that he would always do this, but this edition is weak. So we take from the narration that it is recommended that the regular practice should be to recite Surat As-Sajdah in the first rak'ah and Surat Al-Insan or Al-Dahr in the second rak'ah of the Salat Al-Subh on Yawm Al-Jumu'ah. So the question now is, why did the Prophet pick these two surahs? First of all, we know that Adam alayhi salam was created on a Friday, and this was on the last part of Friday between Asr and Maghrib. And we also know that Yawm al-Qiyamah will be established on a Friday, and we find therefore that these two surahs talk about the beginning of man, who is Adam. It talks about the return on Yawm al-Qiyamah and the people being gathered together. So it is reminding the people what happened and will happen on Yawm al-Jum'ah, so that the Muslims can prepare themselves for this amazing day. And many people go wrong with regards to this sunnah. You would find some of the a'imma reciting part of a sajda in the first rak'ah and part of al-insan in the second rak'ah, and that's wrong. Sometimes they would recite a sajda dividing it up into two rak'at, and in the next yawm al-jum'ah they would recite al-insan dividing it up into two rak'at. Or sometimes they would recite Surat al-Jum'ah and al-Munafiqoon in the Fajr, reminding the other people of Yawm al-Jum'ah. And you would find some of them reciting Surat al-Kahf in order to remind people that Yawm al-Jum'ah is a day where you recite Surat al-Kahf. And all of this, there is no basis for. Rather, we must stick to what has been reported in the Sunnah, which is that you recite the whole of As-Sajda in the first rak'ah and the whole of Al-Insan in the second rak'ah. So now that we know why the Prophet would recite these two surahs, because the occasion warrants it, because these surahs are linked to Yawm al-Jum'ah, can we now make an analogy and say that the Imam, when he is lecturing and preaching his people and he is giving the khutbah, that he should choose the topic of the khutbah relevant to the day and age and the situation in which the people are living? We can say yes, we can make an analogy. So the khatib needs to choose a topic which will interest the people and that which concerns them. So if, for example, the Muslims are facing a particular crisis, then he should speak about this crisis in the light of the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Let's say, for example, a certain Muslim country has been hit with a tsunami or a disastrous earthquake in which life and property has been lost. So the Imam needs to speak about why these disasters happen. Why does Allah Jalla wa Ala allow this to happen? And what is the aim of Allah in doing so? And what can the Muslims nowadays do about this? So the khatib needs to pay great attention in speaking about those topics which the congregation must know about. Hadith 232. وعن حذيفة رضي الله عنه قال صليت مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فما مرت به آية رحمة إلا وقف عندها يسأل ولا آية عذاب إلا تعوذ منها أخرجه الخمسة وحسنه الترمذي. From Hudhayfa he says, I prayed with the Prophet and whenever he passed by an ayah of rahmah, of mercy, he would stop and ask Allah Jalla wa Ala for the mercy. And whenever he recited an ayah of punishment, he would stop and seek protection from the punishment. The five reported it. So this narration is taking place when Hudhayfa prayed behind the Prophet in one of the nighttime prayers. So we take from this narration that you ponder over the ayat you are reciting. Because clearly here the Prophet is understanding and pondering over these ayat. This is why he's stopping and asking Allah for the mercy and seeking refuge with Allah from the punishment. So if the Prophet was not pondering over the ayat, he would not be doing such things. He would simply be zooming over these ayat in no time. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. A blessed book we have sent to you, that they may ponder over its ayat, and that the people of intellect may remember. So now the question is, when you are reciting the ayah in the salah, and you come across an ayah of punishment, or maybe some ayah which is warning you of a punishment, then is it recommended to stop and make dua to Allah to save you from the punishment? Likewise, when you come across an ayah talking of the mercy of Allah or maybe His pleasures or bounty, then is it recommended for you to stop reciting and just make a little dua to Allah to grant you of His mercy? Some ulama say that it is recommended only in the nawafil salah, because this narration is taking place in the nighttime prayer. So they say in the nighttime prayer this is recommended, because it has not been reported that the Prophet did this during the other prayers. However, we say that even if somebody was to do this in the fard prayer, then there should not be anything wrong with this, because whatever is established for the nawafil is also established for the fard. Although we do not think that this is the regular practice of the Prophet. So if somebody does this now and again, then no problem. But the regular practice is not to do this. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says that if you really want to benefit from reciting or listening to the Qur'an, then you need to make sure that your heart is present and you treat the Qur'an as if Allah Jalla wa Ala is directly speaking to you. Because Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. Verily in that, meaning in the Qur'an, there is a reminder for the one who has a qalb, meaning an intellect, who is able to understand. وَأَلْقَى السَّمْعَ, and he throws a hearing, meaning to say, he listens attentively. وَهُوَ شَهِيد, and he is present, meaning his heart is present. Because often you could be listening, your body is present, but your heart is wandering off, thinking about something else. So if all these conditions are met, that the Qur'an is being recited, and you are a person of intellect, and you listen attentively, and you are present with your heart, not just with your body, then and only then will you find benefit in the Qur'an. Otherwise, it will be just any other words being spoken, and you will not take the benefit. Hadith 233. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ألا وإني نهيت أن أقرأ القرآن راكعا أو ساجدا فأما الركوع فعظموا فيه الرب وأما السجود فاجتهدوا في الدعاء فقمن أن يستجاب لكم رواه مسلم. From Ibn Abbas he says, I have been prohibited from reciting the Qur'an in the ruku' or in the sujood. So as for the ruku', then make ta'zeem of the Lord, and as for the sujood, then strive hard in making dua, because it is most worthy that your dua will be answered for you in the sajda position. Muslim reported it. So we take from the fawaid of this hadith that the Qur'an is not to be recited in the ruku' or the sujood positions. This is because the Qur'an is noble speech. And as for the positions of ruku' and sujood, then these are lowly positions and humble positions, not befitting for the high words of the Qur'an to be recited. If the Prophet is prohibited, then all his followers too are prohibited. Most of the scholars say that the ruling on reciting the Qur'an in these positions is that it is makrooh. As for the Zahiriya, they say if you were to recite the Qur'an in these positions, your salah becomes batila. It becomes null and void because you have done something which you are prohibited from doing in the prayer. So it is as if you spoke on purpose of this worldly speech. Of course this would break the prayer. So they make this on the same level. Most scholars say it does not break the prayer. Rather it is makrooh to recite the Qur'an in these positions because it is not a fitting position to be reciting the Qur'an in. As for actually reciting the Qur'an, then of course this is legislated in the prayer. You recite the Qur'an, so it is not the same as you speaking worldly speech, which is not legislated in the very first place in the prayer. So that's the difference between worldly speech and the Qur'an. And also we take, it is obligatory to make ta'zeem of Allah Jalla wa'ala, which is when you speak highly of the status of Allah. And what is intended is that you say, Subhana Rabbi al-Azeem. May Allah the Great be removed from any imperfection. There is also a weak narration in which when the Prophet recited فَسَبِّحْ بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الْعَظِيمِ in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, he said اِجْعَلُوهَا فِي رُكُوعِكُمْ. Make this in your ruku'. And likewise when he said سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, he said اِجْعَلُوهَا فِي سُجُودِكُمْ. Make this in your sajda. So in your sajda you say سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْأَعْلَى. And this is the regular sunnah of the Prophet. And this is also what Hudhayfa reports when he was praying behind the Prophet in the Qiyamul Layl. He says that the Prophet would recite Subhana Rabbi al-Azim in the ruku' and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la in the sajda. And this needs to be said at least once, although the more the merrier. And so this dhikr in the ruku' and the sujood is a wajib of the salah, which means that if you do not say it, then upon you is the sajda as-sahu. Also we take that it is highly recommended to make dua in your sajda. And also the Prophet ﷺ said in the sahih, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدٌ. The closest that a slave is to his Lord is when he is prostrating. So he told us, فَأَكْثِرُ فِيهِ الدُّعَى. So make more dua in this position, meaning the sajda. But what happens if your dua is an ayah of the Qur'an? For example, رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةٍ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَّابُ. This is an ayah of the Qur'an and it's a dua which can be said. Are you allowed to say this in the sajda? The answer is yes, because here you are not intending to recite the Qur'an, rather you are intending a dua. And your actions are judged in accordance with your intention. Al-Imam Malik, Al-Shafi'i and Abu Hanifa, it is their opinion that saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la in the ruku' and sujood positions respectively is mustahab and not wajib. So upon their opinion, if you were not to say this, then there would be no sajda as-sahu upon you. But it appears that the weightier opinion is that it is wajib to say it because of the regular practice of the Prophet. And he said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you see me pray. And also because of the order given in the hadith of the chapter. Is it permissible to make dua in the sajda in a language other than the Arabic language? The answer is yes. So whichever language you find easy, then it is permissible for you to make dua. Because the Prophet said, فَاجْتَهِدُوا فِي الدُّعَى فَقَمِنٌ أَن يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. So strive hard in making dua because it is most worthy to be accepted. He did not say, strive hard in the dua in the language of Arabic. So the Prophet left it in an absolute sense, so we leave it in an absolute sense as well, without making restrictions which the Prophet did not make. Hadith 234. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في ركوعه وسجوده سبحانك اللهم ربنا وبحمدك اللهم اغفر لي متفق عليه. From Aisha, she says that the Prophet would say in his ruku' and in his sujood this dhikr which she mentioned. متفق عليه. So what does this dhikr mean? Subhanaka, may you be removed from imperfection. Allahumma means, O Allah. Rabbana means, our Lord. And وبحمدك, with your praise, it means, with your praises, I remove you from any imperfection. Because the praise of Allah means when you describe Allah with perfection, which is accompanied with love and veneration. So with this praise or description of perfection, I remove you from any imperfection or deficiency. And so the Prophet would make this dhikr in his sujood and ruku' very often when Surah An-Nasr was revealed to him. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. Because in this surah, Allah tells him, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. So make tasbih of your Lord with his praises and seek forgiveness. And you can see then in this dhikr, he is doing exactly that. He is making tasbih with the hamd of Allah and he is making istighfar. So from this narration we find a recommended dhikr for the sujood and ruku'. And this type of dhikr is also relevant to the position, because these positions of ruku' and sujood are lowly positions. So you lower yourself and you seek the forgiveness of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And as you lower yourself, you remove Allah from any lowly position by making tasbih, which is removing Allah from a lowly status and any deficiency and imperfection. So this dhikr is mustahab and not wajib. There is another recommended dhikr which you will find in a dua book, in which the Prophet used to say, Subbuhun Quddusun Rabbul Malaikati Wal Ruh. So the more adhkar you can use to decorate your prayer, then the better this would be. Hadith 235. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قام إلى الصلاة يكبر حين يقوم ثم يكبر حين يركع ثم يقول سمع الله لمن حمدا حين يرفع صلبه من الركوع ثم يقول وهو قائم ربنا ولك الحمد ثم يكبر حين يهوي ساجدا ثم يكبر حين يرفع رأسه ثم يكبر حين يسجد ثم يكبر حين يرفع ثم يفعل ذلك في الصلاة كلها ويكبر حين يقوم من اثنين بعد الجلوس متفق عليه. From Abu Huraira, he says that the Prophet would make the takbiratul ihram in the standing position, and then he would make takbir when he would go into ruku', and he would say Sami Allahu liman hamida when he would be rising and straightening his back from the ruku'. Then in the standing position he would say Rabbana walakal hamd, and he would make takbir when going for the sajdah. This is in the downward motion, and he would say takbir when he would be raising his head from the sajdah, and he would say takbir when going back into the sajdah, and then he would say takbir when rising up from the sajdah to stand up. And he would do all of this in his salah, and he would say the takbir when rising up from the first tashahhud. Muttafaqun alayh. So in this narration, we learn about the takbiratul intiqal, the takbir you make when you move from one position to the other in the salah. We take that you make the takbiratul ihram, the opening takbir, when you are standing up. And indeed, standing up is one of the arkan of the salah if you are able to do it. So you cannot be in a sitting position, make the takbir, and then stand up to pray. You have to say the takbiratul ihram whilst standing up. And the place for the takbiratul intiqal is in between the positions, not in the actual position itself. So from the standing position to the ruku', you say the takbir in between, as you are going down for the ruku', not when you are in the ruku'. And in fact, some scholars say that your salah becomes nullified, because you are saying a legislated dhikr of the salah in other than its proper place. It's a bit like you reciting Al-Fatiha in the ruku'. Nobody would accept this, and your prayer is nullified. Even though this is a strict opinion, but we say that you make the takbiratul intiqal in between the positions. As for this, sami'allahu liman hamida, which means Allah hears those who praise Him, this needs to be understood properly. It does not mean that Allah just simply hears them, because this would actually be no use. Rather, we need to understand it that Allah answers those who praise Him, because Allah hears you and He would answer you. Just hearing on its own is not good enough, and it is not actually a praise of Allah. And this is said as you are rising up. Then when you have stood up after the ruku', you say, رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ. If you are a ma'moom, then the imam would say, سَمِيَ liman hamida, and you do not say it. Rather, you simply rise up, and in the standing position, you would say, رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ. Because the Prophet in the Sahihain said, إِذَا قَالَ الْإِمَامُ سَمِيَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ فَقُولُوا رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ. When the Imam says, سَمِيَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ, then you say, رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ. And the Prophet did not tell you to say, سَمِيَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ. And we have the narration in the Sunan from Ibn Mas'ud. He says, رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُكَبِّرُ فِي كُلِّ رَفْعٍ وَخَفْضٍ وَقِيَامٍ وَقُعُودٍ. I saw the Prophet making takbir for every rising position, lowering position, for every standing position, and for every sitting position. And this is of course in the Salah. So we say that when you are changing from one position to the other, you make the takbiratul intiqal. The exception to this of course is when rising from the ruku', you do not say Allahu Akbar. Rather you would say Sami'allahu liman hamida, for the Imam and the one praying alone, but not for the ma'moom. The big question here is that the takbiratul intiqal, is it mustahab or wajib? There is no doubt that it is legislated, but what's the hukum taklifi? Al-Imam Ahmad says it is wajib, because the Prophet always used to do it, and he would say, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you see me pray. So this is a verbal order that we must do that which the Prophet used to regularly do in the prayer, and that this is wajib. The other three madhahib, they say it is sunnah and not wajib. And they use as their evidence the hadith of the musi, the one who prayed badly, and the Prophet taught him how to pray. He did not tell him that you must make takbiratul intiqal between the positions. And it is important to distinguish between it being mustahab and wajib, because if we say it is wajib and you were to forget to make the takbiratul intiqal, then this means that you have a sajdah sahu upon you. If we say it is mustahab, and then even if you deliberately missed out on saying the takbiratul intiqal, then there is no sajda as-sahu on you. It appears to us that the more favorable opinion is that of Al-Imam Ahmad, that it is wajib, and the Prophet did not tell this to the musi', who is Khalad ibn Rafi', because maybe Khalad knew that you make the takbiratul intiqal and he was doing it, so the Prophet had no need to tell him. Otherwise, the Prophet also did not tell the Musi to recite the tashahhud in the last rak'ah. And we know that the tashahhud in the last rak'ah is certainly wajib, but it could be that the Musi knew about this already, so he did not need to be told this. Hadith 236. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا رفع رأسه من الركوع قال اللهم ربنا لك الحمد ملء السماوات وملء الأرض وملء ما شئت من شيء بعد أهل الثناء والمجد أحق ما قال العبد وكلنا لك عبد اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد. رواه مسلم. From Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he says, when the Prophet would raise up from the ruku', he would make this dua, which he mentions. Muslim reported it. So we take from this narration the recommendation of this dhikr when you are in the standing position after saying Sami'allahu liman hamida, and the minimum that needs to be said after saying Sami'allahu liman hamida, and that which is wajib, is to say Rabbana wa laka alhamd. Anything more than that, as is mentioned in this narration, is mustahab. It will adorn your prayer, but it is not wajib. So if you did not say it, then there is no sajda as-sahu on you. And this dhikr mentioned here is legislated both for the imam and the ma'moom and the munfarid, the one praying alone. And it can be said in the fard prayer and the nafilah. So let's go through the meaning of this dhikr. He says, Allahumma, this means, O Allah. ربنا لك الحمد. O our Lord, to you belong all the praises. It can also be said, ربنا ولك الحمد. O our Lord, and for you are the praises. So he's saying, O our Lord, we have obeyed you and we have praised you. And so because of this, to you belong all the praise, meaning praise in the unrestricted sense. As for humans, they can also have praise, but only when they are worthy of it. So sometimes they can do something worthy of praise, but other times they can do something bad which is not worthy of praise. As for Allah, He is always worthy of praise, because all His actions are good and worthy of praise. مِلْ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمِلْءَ الْأَرْضِ. The fill of the heavens and the fill of the earth. So this is the amount of praise for Allah Jalla wa Ala. So if the praise was a physical body, it would fill the heavens and it would fill the earth. وَمِلْءَ مَا شِئْتَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ بَعْدٍ. And the fill of whatever you want to after the heavens and the earth. So basically now there is no limit to the praise. Because after the heavens and the earth, nobody knows the extent except Allah Jalla wa Ala. So essentially this is saying that there is no limit to the praise which belong to Allah Jalla wa Ala. Otherwise you could argue that if it was the fill of the heavens and the earth, well, this is a finite substance, even though it is huge, but still finite. But when you add this third part, the fill of whatever you, O Allah, want after them, then now there is no limit. أهل الثناء والمجد. So you're saying that Allah is worthy of the thana, which is excessive praise, and He is worthy of al-majd. This is an extremely high, lofty status, a sublime status, the most noble that you can think of. أَحَقُّ مَا قَالَ الْعَبْدِ. The truest thing what a slave has said. Meaning to say, the praise that the slave gives you is the truest thing which a slave could possibly say. And of course this is because Allah is worthy of all praises. وَكُلُّنَا لَكَ عَبْدٌ. And all of us are your slaves. And this is as Allah Jalla wa Ala says, إِن كُلُّ مَن فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِلَّا آتِ الرَّحْمَنِ عَبْدًا. There is nothing in the heavens and the earth except that it will come to the Rahman, meaning Allah, as a slave. So everything, be it animate or inanimate, is a slave of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And it praises Allah in the way that Allah knows. Allahumma la mani'a lima a'tayt. O Allah, there can be no one to withhold what you give. So if Allah wants to bestow some grace on a particular slave, then there could be nobody in the heavens and the earth to withhold that grace or that bounty. And this is as Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Fatir, Ayah 2, مَا يَفْتَحِ اللَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ مِنْ رَحْمَةٍ فَلَا مُمْسِكَ لَهَا. Whatever mercy Allah opens up for mankind, there can be none to withhold it. وَمَا يُمْسِكْ فَلَا مُرْسِلَ لَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. And whatever he withholds, then there can be nobody to grant it thereafter. And he, meaning Allah, is the عزيز الحكيم, the mighty and the wise. And this is where he says, وَلَا مُعْطِيَ لِمَا مَنَعْتِ. And there can be nobody who gives something which you withhold. وَلَا يَنْفَعُ ذَا الْجَدِّ مِنْكَ الْجَدِّ. The word jad here means richness. So he's saying that the richness of a rich person cannot avail him against Allah. So a person has £1 billion. This £1 billion will be of no use to him with Allah Jalla wa Ala. Rather, the only thing which will be of use to him is his heart. Was it full of iman and good actions or evil actions? Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. The day when wealth and children will avail not, except the one who comes to Allah with a sound heart. Likewise he says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَنْ تُغْنِيَ عَنْهُمْ أَمْوَالُهُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ وَقُودُ النَّارِ. Those people who commit kufr, their wealth and children will avail them not against Allah, and they are the fuel of the hellfire. Likewise, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَنْ تُغْنِيَ عَنْهُمْ أَمْوَالُهُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَأُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Those who make kufr, their wealth and children will avail them not against Allah, and they are the dwellers of the fire therein forever. And Nawawi says about this dhikr, and this dhikr contains you leaving your affairs to Allah and depending upon Him, and also you acknowledging the perfection of the power and greatness of Allah, and also his authority over his dominion, and that he alone is the God worthy of worship, and that he organizes and manages the affairs of his creation. Hadith 237. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أمرت أن أسجد على سبعة أعظم على الجبهة وأشار بيده إلى أنفه واليدين وركبتين وأطراف القدمين. From Ibn Abbas, he says that the Prophet says, I have been ordered to prostrate on seven bones, on the forehead, and he pointed to his nose, so all of this is one bone, and the two hands, and the two knees, and the two balls of the feet. Muttafaqun alayh. This narration also has a continuation, which Al-Hafidh did not mention. He says, وَلَا أَكْفِتَ الشَّعْرِ وَالثَّوْبِ, and that I should not gather together the hair and the clothing. So we take from this narration that the Prophet is saying, I have been ordered. So does this mean this is specific for the Prophet and not for us? We say no, this is for the Prophet and also for us. Because what the Prophet has been ordered with is that which we also have been ordered with, except if you have some specific evidence suggesting otherwise. The evidence for this rule is the saying of Allah, لَقَدَ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. For you in the Messenger of Allah is a goodly example. And of course an example is to be followed. Likewise, Allah Jalla wa'ala says,
يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ إِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ فَطَلِّقُوهُنَّ لِعِدَّتِهِنَّ وَأَحْصُ الْعِدَّةِ.
O Prophet, when you divorce women, then divorce them in their proper times and count the time. So he begins by saying, O Prophet, then he switches to the plural form. إِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ, when you, people, divorce women. He did not say, إِذَا طَلَّقْتَ النِّسَاءَ, when you divorce women. You in the singular sense. So there's a difference between طَلَّقْتَ and طَلَّقْتُم. The first one is singular, the second one is plural. So he refers to the Prophet by saying, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيِّ, and then he switches to the plural format. It means that the order for the Prophet is the order for his ummah. As for things which are specific to the Prophet, then we need some clear evidence for this. An example is found in Surah Al-Ahzab, when he's talking about the type of women the Prophet is allowed to marry. He says, وَامْرَأَةً مُؤْمِنَةً إِنْ وَهَبَتْ نَفْسَهَا لِلنَّبِيِّ إِنْ أَرَادَ النَّبِيُّ أَنْ يَسْتَنْكِحَهَا خَالِسَةً لَكَ مِنْ دُونِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And a believing woman, if she gives herself to the Prophet, meaning without a mahr, if the Prophet wants to marry her, specifically for you, O Prophet, to the exception of the rest of the believers. So for the rest of the believers, it is an obligation upon them to give the mahr to the wife. And we find in this narration that it is wajib to prostrate on these seven bones. And this is because the Prophet has been ordered. And when you are given an order, it means it is wajib. And the forehead and the nose are considered as one bone. So you prostrate on your forehead and your nose. In the Arabic language, as-sujood, which is translated to prostration, means when you are lowly and humiliated. And no doubt that the sujood position is one of the arkan of the salah. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ارْكَعُوا وَاسْجُدُوا. O you who believe, make ruku' and make sujood. And most of the scholars say, it is wajib to prostrate on both the forehead and the nose. Some scholars say that if you prostrate on the forehead, and your nose is not touching, then this would suffice. But we say the better opinion is that you must prostrate on the nose and the forehead, just as dictated in this hadith. As for prostrating on the hands, then this is talking about the palms of the hand, and they are on the ground with the fingers joined together, pointing towards the qibla. So these body parts need to be in direct contact with the ground, and not in contact with your clothing. So if you have long sleeves, for example, and you go into prostration, and your hands are inside your sleeve because they are long, then for you to prostrate like this is disliked, although your prostration is still accepted. Rather, we say that your hand needs to be in direct contact with the ground, not your clothing which you are wearing. And the same thing can be said about the imamah. If you're wearing the imamah, then if you go into prostration and put your forehead down, your imamah could come in the way between your forehead and the ground. So this is disliked. Rather, you pull your imamah back so that your forehead can be in direct contact with the ground. So basically, the clothing that you are wearing should not come in between you and your body parts being in contact with the ground. If they did, then this is makrooh.
But if you need to do it for a necessity, for example, the ground is very hot, and if you were to put your forehead on it, it could burn your forehead. So because of this, you put an item of clothing which you are wearing, let's say the imama, on the ground, and you prostrate on that, so this is fine. Or perhaps it's too hot to put your hands on the ground, so you put your hands in the clothing, meaning the sleeve, and you prostrate like that, then this is permissible. And this is what the companions would do, that when they would be prostrating, the ground would be so hot that one of them would have to spread his clothing on the floor and prostrate on that. And the Prophet did not prohibit them from doing this. As for the positions of the feet, then the balls of the feet are on the floor and the toes are pointing towards the Kaaba, and the feet are drawn in together, not spread out apart. This is the sunnah. Otherwise, the minimum is that they need to be on the ground, and that the sajdah is not correct without all the body parts being on the ground. As for if you have a carpet which you are praying on, then if you prostrate, you are obviously prostrating on the carpet, and you are not in direct contact with the ground because the carpet is in the way. But this is permissible because the carpet is not joined onto your body. The carpet is a completely separate entity from your clothing. So this is permissible. It is only makrooh when you prostrate on an item of clothing which you are wearing. And this is of course without a need. If there is a need, then it is not makrooh. What is certainly not permissible is for you to prostrate on your hands. So you put your forehead on your hands and the hands are on the floor. This is not permissible. Rather, your forehead needs to be on the floor and your hands need to be on the floor. But to put your hands on the floor and then your forehead on your hands, then this is not an acceptable sajda. And also, this hadith shows how important it is for us to take the sajda. It is an incredibly important position, and it is a position in which you are closest to Allah Jalla wa Ala, because you have fully lowered yourself. And in the authentic hadith, the Prophet said, مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ سَجَدَ لِلَّهِ سَجْدَةً إِلَّا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهَا حَسَنَةً وَحَطَّ عَنْهُ بِهَا خَطِيئَتُهُ. There is no slave who prostrates to Allah one prostration except that Allah will write for him one good deed because of the prostration, and will remove from him one evil deed of his. Also in the narration he says that I have been prohibited from gathering my hair together. So this is like a ponytail. You are not allowed to pray when your hair is gathered together in a ponytail. This is makrooh. And the reason is because Ibn Abbas said that this is like the one who prostrates with his hands tied behind his back. So one who prostrates with his hands tied behind his back obviously will not be able to prostrate properly. Likewise with the hair tied behind your head. So if you have a ponytail, you need to let go of your hair so that the hair can touch the ground as you prostrate. So this is the key point, that your hair must be allowed to touch the ground as you are prostrating if your hair are long. And it has been reported in the Musannaf of Ibn Abi Shayba that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud told another person to undo his hair even if they become dusty, because every time the hair strand touches the ground, he will have a good deed recorded for him. And likewise, not gathering up your clothing. So this is rolling up your sleeves or rolling up your trousers. If it is done for the sake of the salah, then this is makrooh. If it is done because you are hot and so you have to roll up your sleeves, then this is fine. Hadith 238. وَعَنْ إِبْنِ بُحَيْنَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ إِذَا صَلَّى وَسَّجَدَ فَرَّجَ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ حَتَّى يَبْدُوَ بَيَاضُ إِبْطَيْهِ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. From Ibn Buhayna, he says that the Prophet, when he would enter into the sajda, he would split his arms apart, meaning apart from the rest of his torso, until the whiteness of his armpits could be seen. Muttafaqun alayh. So we take from this, it is mustahab to have your arms apart from your body when in the sajda position. And this type of position shows you to be active and energetic in your salah, not lazy. Likewise, we find that your thighs should be kept away from the rest of the torso, so you're not crimpled up, because this sort of position is a bit more lazy, because now you're resting on your thighs. Rather, the position of the sajda should be an active one, so that you are not resting or leaning against anything and being lazy thereby. Likewise, your calves are kept away from the thighs. Also from this, there is evidence that the armpits are not from the awra, because if they were, then they would have to be covered. But we clearly find here that the whiteness of the armpits of the Prophet could be seen, because his arms were far apart from the rest of his body. And also we find that every body part in the sajda is away from the other body part. So every body part is in its state of worship in the sajda on its own. It is not leaning against some other body part. And so thereby you are active and energetic in your salah, and especially the sajda. And the elbows need to be high up, not on the floor, because then this would be imitating the beast of prey when it is about to pounce on its prey. And you can often see that a cat, when it is about to pounce on a little mouse, it will lower itself down and its arms will be on the ground, and it will leap from its back two feet. Of course, it needs to be noted here that if you are in the Salat al-Jama'ah, then you need to be considerate to your next door neighbor, and you may need to keep your arms inwards so as not to annoy him. And this is because warding off the harms takes precedence over bringing about the benefits. So you need to give precedence to warding off the harms to your neighbor than the benefit of performing the sajda in the perfect way. Hadith 239, وعن البراء بن عازب رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا سجدت فضع كفيك وارفع مرفقيك. رواه مسلم. From Al-Bara' ibn Azib, that the Prophet said, when you prostrate, then put your palms down on the floor and raise your elbows. Hadith 240. وعن وائل بن حجر رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا ركع فرج بين أصابعه وإذا سجد ضم أصابعه. رواه الحاكم. From وائل بن حجر, he says, when the Prophet would be in the ruku', he would split his fingers apart. And when he was in the sajda, he would join his fingers together. This hadith in Al-Hakim is Hasan. So we take from the first hadith that it is wajib to put your palms on the ground. And we said that it is makrooh to put them in your sleeves as you put them on the ground, except for a necessity, like the ground being too hot. If you put part of your palm on the ground, then your prostration is accepted. However, the better way is to have the whole of your palm, including the fingers, on the ground. We find also from the narration that it is mustahab to raise your elbows. And like we said before, this shows that you are energetic in your salah and that you are not lazy. The forearms must not be touching the floor and the elbows are raised, and you do not imitate the beasts of prey as they are about to pounce on their victim. As for this second narration of Wa'il ibn Hujar, it shows us that you put the palms of your hand on the knees when you are in the ruku' and you open your fingers out. As for the sajda, you close your fingers in. And you have to do this because your fingers should be pointing towards the Kaaba. So if all the fingers are going to be pointing towards the Kaaba, then you would have to close them in and bring them together. What about the prostration of the woman? Is it the same as the man or is it different? There is a narration which is mursal, in which the Prophet told two women who were praying that when you two women make the sajda, then draw your body inwards so you don't spread your arms out, because the woman is not like the man in the sajda. So some ulama say it's because it is more concealing for the woman if she draws her arms inwards and does not spread them out, nor the thighs away from the torso and the calf away from the thighs, and that she gathers herself inwards because this is more concealing. However, because the narration is mursal, we do not accept it. And the Prophet said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli, pray as you see me pray. And this is for both men and women. Hence, there is no authentic evidence that the style of the prayer of the man is different to that of the woman. Is the sujood better than the qiyam or not? Shaykh al-Islam says that the qiyam is better than the sujood in terms of what has been recited. Because in the qiyam you recite the Qur'an, and there can be no speech better than the Qur'an. But he says that the sujood is better in terms of the outward image. Because in the sajda you are completely lowered and submissive to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Much more so than the qiyam. So the sujood is better in terms of showing your humility and your submission to Allah. And of course in the sajda you are closer to Allah thereby. And it is a sunnah that when the Prophet would lengthen the qiyam position, he would also lengthen proportionately the ruku' and the sujood positions. And if he would shorten the qiyam, then he would proportionately shorten the ruku' and the sujood positions. And this is the regular sunnah. Hadith 241. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي متربعا رواه النسائي وصححه ابن خزيمة. From Aisha, she says that I saw the Prophet praying متربعاً, which is when you sit with your buttocks on the floor and you sit with your legs crossed. The narration is sahih. So the way we need to understand this narration is that the Prophet would do this when he was ill and he could not stand up. Or if you are praying in nafila, sitting down, which you are allowed to do, then you can sit like this. So this mutarabbi' position is done when it is a substitute for the qiyam position and the ruku' position. But it is not a substitute for the sitting position in the prayer. Because when you are sitting in the prayer, either you will be sitting in the iftirash position or the tawarruk. So when you move to the sitting position in the prayer, you move to the tawarruk or iftirash, depending on where you are in the prayer. But if it is a substitute for the ruku' and the qiyam, then you make the tarabbu', sitting with your legs crossed. So when you move to the first tashahud position in a 3 or 4 raka'ah prayer, then you would sit in the iftirash position. And when you come to the last tashahud position, then you would sit in the tawarruk position. Likewise, the sitting in between the sajdah. This is the iftirash position. So you would not sit with your legs crossed.
Okay, let's take a few review questions. Question number one. Explain what the mufassal suwar are and give their categories. Question number two. Recall the advice of Al-Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah with regards to reciting the Qur'an. Question number three. When in the Salah would you sit cross-legged?